Hello everyone, I am Bharat Singla and welcome to CodeChef. Here we post tons of content on competitive programming. So if you are new to the channel, consider subscribing. Great, now let's get started. So today's video is going to be very important, guys. Today we'll discuss two pivotal topics, the first being the Fibonacci series and the second being how recursion actually works. So we'll burst a lot of myths today. And we'll also solve a lot of mysteries revolving around recursion. So quickly, let's get started. So what is the Fibonacci series? So although this is quite popular, but if you do not know about this, I highly recommend that you pause the video here and given these first few terms of the series, try to figure out the next few terms yourself by analyzing the pattern. So what makes this series so special is that it's not that the difference between any consecutive terms is two or they are all perfect squares. Instead, each term of this series is defined in its own terms. So if you carefully observe here, if you add one and one, so what you get is two, which is this term over here. Then if you add one and two, so you get three, this term over here. Then adding two and three gives you 5, that is this term here. So to generalize, any term is nothing but the sum of the previous two terms of the Fibonacci sequence itself. So this can be extended further. So after 5, if we add 3 and 5, we get 8, right? Then if we add 5 and 8, we get 13, and this can be extended so on and so forth. So let's try to generalize it even further. So let's say fib of n denotes the nth term of this Fibonacci series. So it's very clear that this is nothing but fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2, right? The nth term of the series is nothing but the sum of the n minus 1th term plus the n minus 2th term, that is the previous two terms. So here we have this relation, and this is nothing but a recursive relation. Why? Because the value of a function is given in its own terms, right? So this is what is known as a recursive or a recurrence relation. So now, as we can see, we have defined it in terms of functions, so we can code this out as well. We've just learned the principle of recursion from the previous video. So now let us move on to some kind of a code editor and let's try to code this logic out. So I take an input n, right, and what I output is fib of n, that is the nth term of the Fibonacci series. So now let's try to code this function as well. So int fib that takes an argument n returns fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. So yes, that is exactly what we discussed here. So now let's try to run the code on, let's say, 4. So this should ideally return us the fourth term of the Fibonacci series. And what is it? Well, it is simply this term over here, that is 3, right? So it should hopefully give us 3. Let's see what we get. So it's running and it's showing us the error time limit exceeded, and it's already taken 5 seconds. So even though we passed in such a small value for n, that is 4, why are we getting time limit exceeded? So now let us talk about what was actually happening behind the scenes when we made a call to fib of 4. So we make a call to fib of 4. I am just denoting fib by f, as it is just going to become really grueling for me if I write fib again and again, right? So f of 4 is making two calls, right? One to f of 3, that is n minus 1, and one to f of 2, right? Then f of 3 is making two more calls, that is to f of 2 and f of 1, right? And f of 2 is also making two more calls, that is to f of 1 and f of 0, right? Then f of 2 is going to make two further calls, one to f of 1 and one to f of 0, right? And this f of 1 is going to make two more calls to f of 0 and f of minus 1, right? And this is just going to go on and on and on, right? There's no point where we are stopping, right? this tree is just going to expand infinitely, right? And that is what is giving us the TLE, the time limit exceeded error. So now how do we fix this? So this perfectly brings me to the two-step procedure that you can use to solve any recursion problem. So let's talk about that. Now this is like a tip that you can use everywhere. Whenever you see a recursion question, just apply this two-step process and you will be able to solve it. So the first step is to find a recurrence relation, right? And as you might have guessed that we have already figured this out, right? F of n is equal to f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2. And the second is to find relevant base cases. And that is something what we are lacking in this program. So recall from the previous video, in that Q example, the first person was acting as the base case. He was someone who knew the value and did not bring anyone into the picture, right? He simply returned the value 0 as he knew that the answer for him is 0. He does not need to depend on any sub problem now to get the answer. So now let's try to figure out what the base cases here could be, right? Where this function stops and then it is able to return a value. So this is the Fibonacci series, right? And notice that since each term is given as the sum of the previous two terms, at some point we must know the value, right? So notice that the first number and the second number, they are defined, right? And the rest of the numbers are built based on these. So f of 0, f of 1 and f of 2 are something that is given, that is 1 and 1. So these are the points which are going to help terminate our program, right? So what is the new relation that we have? It is that f of n is equal to 1 if n is equal to 1 or 2, otherwise f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2. So now we have basically completed this two-step process, and now hopefully we should get the right answer. So now let's add the base cases. That is nothing but an if condition to our program. So if n is 1 or n is 2, right? In that case, simply return 1, right? Otherwise, return fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2, right? So now let us try to run the code again on 4. And what we should get? We should get 3, right? So yes, we are getting 3 here, right? And now let's see what was happening this time. So notice that when this tree was now called, then these f of 0s and f of minus 1, they are basically not called, right? And in fact, f of 2 is a terminating condition as well. So no calls after f of 2 are made. Right, so this is our new recursion tree. So notice that now, after adding a lot of these ones, we get the final value for f of 4, right? And that is 3. So now, if you are already well versed with recursion, you might be wondering that, Bharat, this is incorrect. A recursion tree doesn't expand breadth wise, instead, it expands depth wise. So, yes, that is what we are going to discuss now. So till now, I've just been making the calls randomly, right? I did not basically use any kind of an order, but now let us try to prioritize which calls are being made first, right? So f of 4 doesn't simply make a call to f of 3 and f of 2. So let's see which calls are being made first before the others. And for this, instead of just using the recursion tree, I'll also use a stack, right? So the stack structure is a very useful structure, I would say, because that helps you to understand the concept of recursion much, much better, right? So I made a call to f of 4, right? And there's another stack, right? So this is a stack, which is nothing but the visual representation of the computer's memory. So whenever a recursive function call is made, notice that f of 4 doesn't have its value right now, since it does not simply have a return statement. It first depends on f of 3 and f of 2. So It must be somewhere stored temporarily, right? Whatever a function is returning, it must be somewhere stored, right? So this is where the function calls are stored. So f of 4 is making two calls, right? So first f of 4 is being added to the stack. So now f of 4 calls f of 3. So now since f of 3 has been called, f of 3 would be added to the stack as well, right? And before calling f of 2, what will happen is that first f of 3 is going to figure out what its value is, right? So this doesn't just go for any recursive function, but it goes for any function. So if in a function we are calling another function, like in a recursive function we are calling itself, so any lines after that are only executed when the function we are calling has done the job it is expected to do. Like here, before calling f of 2, it will first, since it made a call to f of 3 first f of 3 is going to compute its value, right? Only then f of 2 will be called. So here, once f of 3 is called, f of 3 will first compute its value. So for that, it will make a call to f of 2, right? And again, before making a call to f of 1, first f of 2 must do the job it is expected to do. Now, since f of 2 is a base case, it's simply going to return a value, and it's also going to be added to the stack, right? So now f of 2 is, since it's a base case, it's going to return a value, right? And that is 1, as we wrote in our code. And now f of 3 can successfully make a call to f of 1. Now since f of 2 has returned its value, so f of 2 can now be erased from the stack as well, right? So after a function returns its value, basically has done what it's expected to do, it gets erased from the stack. So this way, a recursive function is memory efficient as well. So after f of 2 has returned its value, it gets erased from the stack. Then f of 3 is fully capable to make a call to f of 1. So f of 1 gets added to the stack as well, right? And then since f of 1 is a base case as well, it simply returns the value 1 and it gets erased from the stack as well. And now notice that f of 3 can now figure out its value, that is simply by summing f of 2 and f of 1. So this is 1 plus 1, so it can simply return the value 2 back, that is 1 plus 1. And now, since f of 3 has returned its value, it can now be erased from the stack as well. Now you might be wondering that what is the need of this stack? So this is very useful in computing the space complexity of a program, because this is, as I said, is a representation of the computer's memory. So the maximum length that the stack is taking, that is the maximum calls it is holding at some point of a time, is the space that your program is taking. So now f of 4 can fully make a call to f of 2, since f of 3 has returned a value that will get added to the stack as well, right? And since f of 2 is a base case, it can return 1, right? And then it will be erased from the stack as well. And finally, after all that hard work, we have the value of f of 4, that is nothing but summing f of 3 and f of 2, which is nothing but 2 plus 1, which is 3. And since it has returned the value, it can be erased from the stack as well. So that's what was actually happening behind the scenes when we made a call to fib of 4. And notice how the stack was initially empty before the function and empty after the function has executed as well. So notice how beautifully the stack got filled and erased. So in the start also there was no memory consumption, and after the function has finished, there's again an empty memory, right? So this is how f of 4 is being calculated. So what we just discussed was the tree structure of a recursive function as well as the stack structure of a recursive function. So before we wrap up, there are two things that I want to convey. So the first is that I'm leaving as an exercise for you that notice what would have happened if before making a call to fib of n minus 1, we would have made a call to fib of n minus 2. So fib of n minus 2 plus fib of n minus 1. So would the answer be different in that case, or would the order of the function calls be different? Like, just brainstorm about that. And the second thing is that if you did not know that CodeShift conducts free live sessions on Unacademy, where we try to teach every possible topic related to competitive programming, and that too, not just as recorded videos as you are just watching here, but a live session. so you can interact with the teachers as well. There, the CodeChef educators, who are world-class educators, are taking live classes on Unacademy, and to attend them, all you have to do is either download the Unacademy app or register yourself at unacademy.com by choosing your goal as competitive program. And then you can just start attending the live sessions. And remember, they are free. And if you want to go, you can go for the paid plus subscription as well, where you get much, much additional benefits like mentor help, full-time doubt solving, and problem sets curated by these educators for each topic. And while registering, when they ask you for a code, so you can use the code Bharat27 to register there. So happy coding, guys, and this winds up the video. So thanks for watching, guys. If you like the video or just learned something new, don't forget to hit the like button and leave down a comment if you have any queries or suggestion or some feedback. You can also join our Telegram channel. The link is in the description box below to stay even more updated. I am Bharat Singla signing off for now, and I'll see you next time.